brothers and sisters, the president of the National AFL-CIO, President Richard Trumka.
Fred, I want to thank you for that overly kind introduction. And I wanted to thank you and Leo and Stan and Tom and the full executive board for inviting me to your convention. It's good to be here at this important, groundbreaking, and powerful union, because this is truly, as your theme says, a union that works. And I want to say a few words about your president for a second, who is one of my closest friends, one of my closest colleagues, and a great union leader. But he's not just a leader of the steelworkers, because he leads around the world. At the AFL-CIO, he's well respected and a leader, and around the world, he has the steelworkers' names out there, and he has all of you out there in his heart. And I want to say he's one of the best trade unionists that I know, and the best friend that I've had. Please give a round of applause to your president, Leo Gerard. Now, I have some good stuff to talk to you about today. First of all, I want to congratulate you for being a union that doesn't give up, that takes a refinery off the chalking block, and for instance, and keeps it from closing by finding a new buyer. And you've got a million of those examples, and each one is really incredible in its own way. This is definitely a union that works. And I also have some hard subjects to discuss today about the unity of our movement, about Democrats and Republicans, about where we stand in the middle of all of it. First, I want to say this about this union. There's no union like the steelworkers. Just the sheer width, yeah, you ought to clap, you've earned that. Just the sheer width and the depth of your membership sets you apart. But so does your activism. Because nobody fights as hard against illegal foreign subsidies or Chinese currency manipulation and job exporting as you do. And no one struggles as hard to save and to revitalize American manufacturing as you do. And nobody has represented and won more trade cases than the steelworkers. And year after year after year, you break new ground in organizing. And I want to congratulate you for that, and I want to thank you for that. You see, you look at the world with an eye of opportunity, and I really appreciate that. You carry on the best traditions of the men that I'm proud to call my friends and my brothers, going all the way back to Phil Murray and I.W. Abel, George Becker, and my friend Lynn Williams. That's the traditions that you carry on. This union's always been blessed with great leadership. And I can tell you something, the leadership that you have in front of you right now is every bit as good as it's ever been in the steelworkers. You ought to be proud of them, and you ought to support them, and you ought to stand behind them, and you ought to let them know that you'll care for them and you thank them. Thank you, guys. Now I want to tell you a story. Back in May of this year, I went to Pittsburgh for the convention of the Pennsylvania State AFL-CIO. Some of you might have been there. And at that convention, we had a panel of workers who were in the middle of an organizing drives. One of those organizers, those workers was organizing, was a woman named Rebecca Taxel. She teaches English at Point Park University in Pittsburgh. And she's been an adjunct professor for almost 20 years. And she said something to me that I've been thinking about ever since. She said that she still only earns about 20% of what a tenured faculty member makes. Now think about that. After 20 years, she earns 20%. She brings in something like $6,700 for a semester. That's what she lives on. She's got no job security to speak of. She's developed college courses on her own time, with her own money, only to be told at the last minute, oh, we're sorry, there's really no need for that course after all. Now, adjunct teachers like Rebecca make up a majority of university faculty in the United States. 75%. Think about that. 75% are adjunct professors. And those teachers work hard. And Rebecca gives her students a quality education. Rebecca told me that she sometimes asked herself, you know, why am I doing this? And this is her reply. She said, I was trained to do this. I love to do this. I'm a teacher. And I just want to get a little respect for the work that I do. Just a little respect, she said. Well, let me tell you, brothers and sisters, Rebecca is going to get more than just a little bit of respect from me and from her employer, too, because she and her co-workers at Point Park voted to form a union with AFA, USW this summer, and she's going to get the respect that she's earned over the last 20 years. Because we know that a union is the best tool to win respect, to turn a bad job into a good job, one with pay and benefits, chance for secure retirement. Because when we stand together, we're powerful. We earn respect. And there's no denying it. It works. Unionism works. See, brothers and sisters, we aim to help working families use unionism to build a better life. And I'm not saying that because I like the sound of the words. I'm saying it because it's true. Unionism works. This union builds strong careers, strong families, strong communities, and a strong future for the United States of America and Canada. Because we know that the best way to fair pay is a union contract. And the best way to get a secure retirement is with a union contract. And the best way for a better tomorrow so you can give your family a decent life and a strong future, it all comes back to a decent contract, a union contract. Now look, we live in the richest nation on the face of the earth, at its most rich point in time. And a decent life isn't too much to ask for, because we're the workers of this country. From the foundry to the freeway, we forge steel and smelt aluminum, we mine ore and store slurry, we build turbines and make paper, we bake bread and teach classes, we lift all the loads and answer the call. We do whatever it takes, no matter the cost. We wake this country up every single day and we put her to bed every single night. And it's time that we said to this country that we won't be turned aside, that we won't be sat down or backed up, we won't be shut up, we won't be forced down, we won't be denied. This is our country, and it's time that we took it back for the workers of this country. You know, brothers and sisters, in the past few months, I've spoken to workers all across the United States. And I don't get to talk to Canadian workers as much as I'd like to, but I do talk to Canadian workers as well. And to be perfectly honest with you, the people that I talk to, the workers that I talk to, union and non-union, are confused. And they're angry, and they're frustrated, and some of them are scared. They tell me they're worried about their future. They're concerned about the life of their children are going to be able to lead. And they're wondering how, this long after the financial collapse of 2008, sometimes it seems like just too little has changed. Well, I want you to know something. I understand that frustration. I understand that fear. I understand that confusion. Because let's consider what's happened over the last 40 years. How productivity rose while wages froze, which meant virtually all of the wealth that we created has gone to the richest 1%, and in most instances, to the richest 0.1%. As union women and men who represented your members, you've seen the day-to-day toll that this trend has taken on workers. You've seen how corporations sometimes rig themselves to fail so that executives can break pension promises and walk away with millions of dollars in bonuses. And we've seen profitable companies use the struggles down the street to justify their own health care cuts and their attempts at takeaway contracts. And when a factory or a plant closes, or it moves its production to China or anywhere else, well, all of us have seen the ripple effects that flow across our communities. Half-empty classrooms, for sale signs popping up in the front yards of our friends and neighbors and coworkers. Restaurant closures, vacant storefronts, and the most telltale sign. You see, workers who look like they've had all the life plucked out of their eyes, they're lifeless. That hope and excitement about a better day and a better future ripped away from them. And it hits home. It hits home. Because these are fights over finances, over worn out clothes that just have to be worn anyway. Nothing much for the kids at Christmas. Stuff that counts in our lives. Stuff that hurts in our lives. And that's the story of the past 40 years. And it's been tough on all of us. Because our economies don't work when work doesn't pay. The situation has given workers everywhere a real hard-won education in real economics. And think about this, we see a lot of people, especially a lot of people with college degrees that haven't thought of themselves as workers. A lot of people didn't understand the connections between their neighbors and themselves. Well, they didn't have to, because we had a generation of strong union contracts that kept us in pretty good shape. But when it started to fray, well, that just wasn't the case anymore. And so workers like Rebecca Taxel up in Pittsburgh have begun to say things like this: we're going to call ourselves workers because that's what we are, and we're going to change things because they need to be changed, and they can be changed, and they will be changed when all of us get up off of our fat asses and lock arms together and make up our minds that we are going to change this country and make it work for every last worker out there, not just that thin crust up at the top. Well, here's why I'm telling you this, because the biggest story in America is the great wealth divide and what we're going to do to make it right. See, that's the news story in America. People everywhere are starting to understand themselves as workers. People all across the country and around the world are beginning to see the collective action as a solution to our troubles. From fast food to forged steel and everywhere in between, more and more people are talking about economic inequality. People who never spoke the words before. And the public is beginning to debate the big issues, like a living wage and like collective bargaining. And we're talking about raising wages. And guess what? They like the idea of us talking about raising wages for Americans. And I can tell you this, people who like that idea are going to love the reality of raising wages a whole lot more. Because you see, household expenditures make up 70% of the American economy. And that's how raising wages will create jobs, because when workers do well, America does well. We buy goods. We buy services to improve our lives. We create demand. And then corporations have to hire workers to meet the demand that we create. You can call it a virtuous cycle. And it's the exact opposite of a race to the bottom, because it's the foundation of a strong economy built on raising wages, not credit card debt or asset bubbles. And we're spreading the word. At the AFL-CIO, we've got a program called Common Sense Economics. How many people out there have heard of Common Sense Economics, the program we have? Raise your hand. You have a program at the Steelworkers similar to it. It's a great program. And together, we're going to reach out to 1 million regular working people and teach them how raising wages works. And we'll use that information to continue to build momentum for working people. And then we got some other initiatives too that I'll touch on. You see, we're strengthening our state federations and our central labor councils, because this union believes, like my union does, that the labor movement starts from the bottom up, not from the top down. And if you got strong local unions and you got strong central labor councils, you're going to ultimately have a strong labor movement. Right. And we're joining together with our community partners and allies in ways that we've never done. You see, we're a mainstream movement. And finally, we're starting to act like it. Because 80% of the American public believes in the values that we believe in. And yet we've allowed that 20% to put us on the defensive and make us act like we're asking for too much when it's the vast majority of Americans that agree with us. America's tired of losing middle-class jobs. From Montana to the Gulf of Mexico, from Ontario to California coast, we're done with the downward spiral. And in poll after poll after poll, we hear Americans saying that we want an economy that works for everyone, not just the wealthy few. And Leo knows this. We, you know, at the AFL-CIO, we do our own polls, and we just ask a group of voters if they agreed with this simple statement. We need to make sure that all of us, not just the CEOs, get our fair share in the economy. That was the statement. And when we asked those making less than $50,000 a year, two out of every three that we asked said, yes, we need to make sure all of us, not just CEOs, get our fair share. You know, and I thought, 66% should be a lot higher. I wasn't overly impressed with 66%, but guess what? Here's the kicker. We only asked that of registered Republicans, and two-thirds of them said, yep, all of us ought to get a fair share. So even a majority of conservative working class Republicans share our values. And here's what that means to me. It means a solid majority of working people of every stripe share the same basic challenges, the same hopes, the same dreams. And economics are at the heart of our problems. Because you see, the economy's not like the weather. Can't do anything about the weather. The economy's nothing but a set of rules. And those rules decide who wins and who loses. And those rules are made by men and women that we elect. You see, working people may embrace a range of philosophies, religions, and political points of view, but we're still united by the circumstances of our life and by the visions and by the hopes that we share. And so it's up to you and it's up to me. It's up to each one of us to help bridge the gap for the workers who share our values, but who don't yet see how our interests intersect. And that's why we're reaching out to all workers. Even if they fly the Tea Party flag, because when it comes to economic issues, we really have to all stand together so that the voices of America, our America, can be heard in the workplace and in our national life. Because work should never hold us down. Work should never trap us in poverty. Work should lift us up. And we want our country to work for the people who work. And here's the good news. Power and hope are rising. We're on the right path, brothers and sisters. A groundswell is growing, and it keeps getting bigger, and it keeps getting stronger. And it's a movement to raise wages, so that all of us can live a better life. You see, we'll stand together to raise wages for all. We'll fight for athletes and car wash workers, for Harley workers and security guards, nurses and teachers. We'll march together for working families, for good pay. We'll stand together for a strong future for each other, and we won't back down until we win a new day for the American dream. And we'll shout here in Vegas, and we'll shout all across this country, and we'll show how much good raising wages can do to create the economy that we want, that we need, that we must have, and that we shall have. That sounds good, but believe me, it's hard to unite a movement. I know how tough it is to mobilize and motivate a membership as diverse as ours, as broad and strong and varied as are the workers of the Steelworkers and the AFL-CIO. And I've talked to workers who say to me, Rich, why don't we start a labor party? And then they complain about our leaders who haven't done enough, or the do-nothing right-wingers in Congress who oppose progress and run down our great country. And here's what I tell them. I say America's never been more polarized in my lifetime. And that goes the same for some of our own members. Here's what I say, there's no secret formula to carry unionism into every part of our country, to bring together those who have been divided by cynicism and the vain idea that we're better off alone than together. Yet we can bring ourselves together. We've already started, and it's working. Working people share a lot more than most of us think. Listen to this. In our research, we found what we're calling Tea Party populism, and we'll stand with them. Together, we can turn cynicism into stubborn action. Because guess what? It's time for us to believe in us. Time for us to believe in ourselves again. Time for us to believe in the strength of our movement. Time for us to believe in the progress that's possible in our democracy when workers stand together. Because we care about the same things. 82% of the public wants good American manufacturing jobs, not more bad trade deals. And that's an idea that unites us. And if Congress won't take action to support American jobs and end bad trade deals, it's our responsibility to continue to build a movement, one that can't be ignored, so that we get a Congress that will, and the pundits and the politicians in Washington, they've never really understood the power of a movement. They're always looking to the past. But guess what? We're the future. They look to the past, but we're the future. 90% of American people want an end to Chinese currency manipulation. 90%. That's an idea that unites us. And yet corporations that benefit from China's cheap currency still rule the day in Washington. And they think their deals can't be stopped. But we know better, because they're looking to the past instead of looking to us, because we're the future. See, we'll fight from town halls and county commissions to state houses all the way to Capitol Hill. We'll fight in Ontario and San Juan, Puerto Rico, because no one, and I mean no one, controls our destiny but us. We control our destiny. In the history of the world, We've always had to fight for everything we got, and that's what we're doing. We're building power the hard way, and we've learned some mean, mean political lessons about the red-blue divide, hard political lessons. But I want you to listen about what I'm about to say. We're stronger because of those lessons. We're more independent because of those lessons. We're more focused, we're more disciplined, we're more creative, and we are more powerful because of those lessons. And we're asking hard questions of every single candidate who comes and wants our support. Do you support America's workers? Do you support American manufacturing? Do you support our right to bargain collectively for a better life? Do you support good jobs? Will you grow the economy, not shrink it? Will you raise our wages? Will you do that? Please tell us how. Don't just ask us to take it on faith anymore. Because we're not working for any candidate, and we're not building power for any political party, not the Democratic Party and not the Republican Party. We're building power for working people, pure and simple. We're taking the long view, and we'll work for anybody who works with us, and we're not afraid to hold anybody's feet to the fire, no matter what the political party that they believe in. Just let me tell you one more thing. We're not going to hold our nose and line up behind any Democrat just because there's a D next to his or her name. That's not good enough. That won't happen. We deserve better. Working people need results, period, not excuses. And yet I promise you this, I swear that no one will work harder, smarter, or longer to elect the leaders who make the right commitments, and nobody will work harder, longer to defeat those who don't, regardless of party. This electoral season, I want you to work like never before. I want you to be leaders who lead by example. Be the first out there to knock on doors. Be the first one at the phone bank to make those calls. And when you do, you'll motivate your volunteers, and you'll strengthen your activists, and you'll help us connect with more working class voters and get more working families to the polls. Because if we want the policies that we need the right leaders in every corner of America, we've got to engage. We've got to turn out people. We need you to release staff, and we need you to do it right now, to turn out people. And when I say our people, I mean members, and I mean our families, but I also mean like-minded individuals in our neighborhoods and our communities, the people you go to church with, people you see at Little League or at high school events, people you see at the grocery store, people you see walking down the street. And after the polls close on election day, we'll have a strong network of activists and local leaders ready to mobilize and pressure those leaders to support our organizing for the union members of tomorrow. You see, we're changing lives. We're scrambling and we're reaching for a little hope. And we have a vision, and we're going to make that vision a reality, because when all of us pitch in, it's called shared responsibility and shared sacrifice. And when we get that, we have wins together. From the paper mill to the refinery, full-time, part-time, anytime, from the car wash to the tire plant, we win together when we stand together. So get off your seats and on your feet, brothers and sisters. When we stand together, we win together, and I promise you we're going to win together. But we have to work for it. We have to stand for it together, each one of us, with solidarity, real solidarity, where your picket line is my picket line and my picket line is yours. And I don't bother asking questions about what's that guy striking for over there. I see a worker striking. I support that worker. Shoulder to shoulder, arm in arm, all day, every day, to win together, to raise wages together, to grow together, to bring out the best in each other in America, for the America we can have, must have, will have. Keep fighting, keep winning, keep being a union that really works.